Those make you 50% of the area median income, which translates to $45,300 for a family of four, or $31,750 for a single resident. And so the question is, when it comes to developing new affordable housing in the district, is that level too high? If so, what should be the income level that affordable housing is aimed at? And I'm looking here for a specific number. Where do you think things stand? Are those the right numbers? Should the numbers be pushed down, and if so, to what level? Thank you. I'll take this question. We all know the median income is high, and there's no specific number, because income in a community ranges from 10, 20, 30, 50, and goes up. We need to make sure there's enough affordable housing to fill in those blocks. We have an opportunity here, folks. The mayor plan does not work.
Yes,
and the reason it does not work is because there is no oversight. There's no oversight for those tenants that live in NYCHA building. Oftentimes, money goes to different repairs, and I've been there. There's no repairs happening. And it acts over and over and over for oversight over those monies. We're not saying it here, but we need to give folks the opportunity to purchase those apartment buildings. We were talking about affordable housing. Let's talk about home ownership. Let's talk about providing an opportunity to create jobs within the community so folks can move from one income level to another income level. This is part of a holistic approach. We can't just look at it from you're making $10,000, so you should stay making $10,000. Let's create an opportunities in the community for you to move from one income level to another income level. Let's create an opportunity for you to be able to purchase your home you live in. And if you can't purchase, you should at least have oversight over management and the funds that goes towards repairing your home. Thank you.
You know, these terminologies sometimes sound sexy and sound attractive, but the details sometimes can be misleading. So for instance, if the area median is sort of like an average, let's assume for the sake of conversation it's an average, because these terminologies sometimes are not accessible, but it's basically, let's say it's an average. So if you live over here, and the average income is 100, and over there where y'all live is the 200. The area we're talking about is the income of the people in this room. So 100 and 200 divided by 2 is 150. Who's not going to be here? Raise your hand. You are not going to be. That's the problem with those type of measures, because they are scientifically correct, but personally, they can be very misleading, because the area median income from your point of view is what's in your pocket. So if what's in your pocket is 100 and not 150, that's what the area median income is supposed to be for you, right? Okay, that's the problem with those using those type of measures. So the city council, however, can have some influence over how those measures are used that makes sense for what's in the pocket of the people that you're trying to represent. And if you don't understand that, then you could go for the okey-doke and say, yeah, I got 200, so it's good for me. But the reality is your neighbor and others in that general area that's being measured may not measure up to that. And guess what's gonna happen? Gentrification. Okay? But I'm telling you, and all those other kind of displacement practices are what have become the reasons many of our communities have been victimized. So I'm not against measures that are fair, but we have to be careful that the formula is designed by the whose pocket are they going to use to measure what is affordable? Your pocket or my pocket?
Well, I just gave you the number that the city is using for much of its affordable housing, $45,300 for a family of four. And my question is, if that's too high, then what should the number be? Because this is not hypothetical. The winner of this race will be sitting in the city council in a matter of weeks, casting votes and participating in debates about these very numbers.
I'm sorry. In conclusion, all I want to say is I have been victimized by these type of measures in the past. Our communities have been, they'll put out a proposal that says A, and they'll sound like it's in your pocket, but it's not. So we have to look at what is affordable in terms of what's in the pocket of the people that are going to have to use that particular housing. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. I would say a number, probably for this neighborhood, particularly East Harlem, where the zoning is going to take place, maybe between $29,000 and $30,000 would be affordable in that area. Because what's going to happen is the mayor's plan, and I think it's good intention, is driving homelessness. That's why the homeless numbers are going up. This is the same plan that started under Koch, Bloomberg, and Giuliani. They haven't changed the affordable housing plan. And so what's happening is big developers are building in our communities, and even, you know, 30% of it is so-called affordable, it's not affordable to the people in the community. So that's what's pushing people out of the community. I would say if we want a number, I would say about $29,000 to $30,000 a year.
Thank you. Mr. Fields, you
I agree with that assessment. I would believe between $28,000 and $30,000. I think what we need to do is what may be affordable for me may not be affordable for you. And we have been trying to apply this one size fits all mechanism where we pile a number that we randomly think is affordable that everybody can get on board with, and which we have found out is that is not so. Affordable is different for everybody else. And I think we need to have an escalating scale that seeks to help all people, no matter if you're making $15,000, $10,000, $20,000, $25,000, $30,000. I think it is egregious and preposterous that you can pay upwards of 50% of your income in rent in any given year and expect to still maintain your house, do other supplementary bills, especially if you want to have kids. So I believe we need to have an escalating scale. We need to really redefine the term affordable and understand that affordable for you is not what's affordable for me. And second of all, we need to really start to really look at new other approaches to housing. One, we need to revamp our lottery system. Our lottery system, which brings in which gives a lot of people opportunity to get out of public housing and go to these other buildings. Sometimes it can be coalescing, it can be confusing, and the waiting process and how people get selected is ambiguous in nature as well. So we need to revamp our house lottery system and give more people an opportunity to get housing and not have to be so selective. So I believe that we want you to redefine the term affordable, have an escalating scale to meet people where they're at, and then revamp our housing lottery system.
Mr. Outlaw.
I think that the major problem is that the AMI encompasses Westchester County, high rated counties that are more, they have more in their pocket, so to speak, to what the senator was saying. And we have people in the state legislature that live up in wherever county they're from, and they're making rules for New York City, which I don't think that's fair. I think we should also look at repealing the Erstat law, and because, you know, all these other things that we have here, other problems that we have here, if you can't pay your rent, how are you going to live in a community and care about education and everything else when you don't have the money in your pocket to pay your bills and keep a roof over your head?
Yeah, I just
wanted
to piggyback on that to say that we need to also look at the rent guidelines board and how regulations are determined in terms of rent increases, because that's going to be a major factor in all of this equation. We have to look at funding and financing when we talk about AMI, because the lower the affordability that we want for our communities, then the more subsidies that we need. And we have to be prepared to make the arguments for where those subsidies should come from. And we know that there have been many arguments made about the low-income tax credit, and we're seeing a more conservative push to repeal, you know, programs that were established specifically so that we could provide a supplement in areas where we need more supports for housing. And so I would like to see a future plan that involves a mix that includes financing options that help us to preserve affordability, to make sure that the AMI speaks to the community at the lowest rungs and the lowest amounts, and at the same time that we have a mix that deals with the new gentrification and the development that's being made that deals with moderate and middle income households.
I agree with what the Senator Perkins said. Different areas have different incomes. So you may make $100,000 on the side and $150,000, but then also what is not noted are the people who do not make any income, and that's not included in these numbers. So it's very important that we include them. So the number that Mr. Holland suggested, 29 to 30,000, yes, off the top of my head I would say that, but we really need to know what the real numbers are so that we'd be able to get an exact number. Thank you.
So in this next section of the debate, we're going to allow you to ask each other questions. So we're going to start with Ms. Simmons, who can ask any one of the other candidates one question that you can direct at a single candidate, and then we'll just go down the line and continue.
Senator Perkins, you've already been city council member before. You've done very well, and I've always saw you everywhere, so I know you were a great, city council member. And you've gone on to city, to move up upstate to state senate. So my question is, given that you've moved on and you've already done this, what is it worth coming back and stripping that card, you know, all these people that come to the city?
And I appreciate your question very much. You know, the privilege to represent you is based simply on what I believe I can do best for you. And my experience, having been in the city council and in the state legislature, and even looking at the potential of going to a place like Congress, has informed me that I can do the most for you as a constituency through work in the city council. Simple as that. And I have a record that reflects that, and I've had the experience in these other places to know the difference between what you can do here and what you can do there. So that's as simple as that. It's not anything much more than that. The purpose we are all here is to see what we can deliver to our constituents and to see how we can do that in the best of our ability and in terms of the institution where we think we can best deliver. So I've had more than one institution to be able to work in, and I've decided, I think, the institution that I was in before, the city council, is a place where I can bring more home to the people that I represent. That's as simple as that. The same people that I'm representing in the state, Your turn to ask a question. Okay. So let me just first ask the question by complimenting anybody at the dais for daring to step forward and try to represent the best interests of the neighborhood. And I really say that sincerely. I just want to know one of the most important things that you have done that you think you can do as per the opportunity that you'll get as a member of the city council.
Who are you asking?
That's one person. Well, then I'll make it easy. Cordell, who I know has something to say.
Yeah.
I've done a number of things. I think one of the most significant things that I've done as the parent of a child affected by lead poisoning in this community. I was able to work, form, and lead a coalition, citywide coalition, of parents, health professionals, elected officials, and housing advocates, legal advocates, and so on, in a 12-year battle to create the most comprehensive piece of lead paint prevention legislation in the country. Was passed in 2004, and then Councilmember Bill Perkins was the city council sponsor of the bill. It was not helpful to my child, but since 2004, it has saved thousands of children in this city. So I am very, very proud of that. I'm very proud of my work on community school boards, which is a thing of the past, but I served on it, and we were able to create fairer enrollment policies. This district is divided between two or three school districts, and the one I was in was District 3, which goes from 59th Street in the Upper West Side up to 122nd Street. And I saw the difference between the schools below 110th Street and the schools above 110th Street. And I was able to work with that board and make the playing field a little fairer in public school education.
Please ask your question of anyone.
I'm addressing my question to Mr. Fields. I want to know what your thoughts are on all the money that is being poured into campaigns and elections, and how do you feel about that?
Me personally, I believe that the will and the voice of the people should be heard far louder than the reach in the pockets of people who decide to donate or buy elections because certain people has pledged their loyalty or special interest groups have gotten to them. We are a democracy of people, even though we might have conflicting ideas or conflicting beliefs at the end of the day. We are here to represent people, to represent their best interests, and to put something forward that can unify, energize, and invigorate the community to reach higher levels and higher platforms. So I'm against any form of diluting that democracy by oversaturating the market with money that has dark influences to buy politicians, to be in the pockets of developers or structures. I am not in the business of backroom politics. I am in the business of the government with the people, by the people, for the people.
I was just reminded of Dawn's question, which was the initial question I was going to ask to the senator. But what I will do instead is to ask the question to Mr. Holland. Certainly you have continued to build your reputation working closely with unions. And while I support labor and the needs that they serve and started my own career in labor at DC 37, I know that as you prepare for an election such as this, that having the support of unions can also tip the scale, if you will, in helping to have equity in elections. And so how have you dealt with your support from unions, and how do you see yourselves achieving a more fair and equitable election?
I am an unapologetic union man. I think, you know, one of the things I'm going to be pushing is that development should be done, infrastructure should be done by union work in this town. That would go a long way toward alleviating a lot of the problems we're having with stuff like affordable housing if we had more union members. So I'm unapologetic being a union person. I don't know what to say about that, is that that's who I am. You know, I'm a transit worker for over 27 years, and the labor, yes, I have great labor support, but that labor support is coming to me because I'm one of them. I'm a blue collar guy. I clean train stations for a living. So that sweat, they understand that when I get there, I'm gonna be fighting for all workers, both union and non-union members, when I get there. It was the labor movement that pushed the minimum wage up to $15 an hour. So when the labor movement is moving up, all of society is moving up. We built the middle class. We bought you a weekend. So the fact that I'm a union person is a great thing for Harlem and a great thing in this election.
Mr. Allen, you
will
ask me the next question.
Well, I was going to ask my question to Mr. Perkins. You get lucky tonight, then. I'm going to ask Athena my question since she asked me. Where do you live and how long have you lived?
It's a fair question, and I don't hide or run from it. So I live on 128th Street in Harlem, and I live there with my beloved 11-year-old, and I'm a ride or die Harlemite. Okay, and the reason most have been interested in that question is because they hear about my upbringing in the South Bronx to a mentally ill mom and a father who passed away when I was 6, who was a war veteran who succumbed to substance abuse. I am Harlem because my father lived in Harlem at the Savoy. I am Harlem because my aunt, the oldest member of the Polo Grounds, Minnie Cambridge, lived there, and I worked closely with her, and many of you know Mama Minnie. I also am Harlem because I work in a storefront on 125th Street, the only one on this dais who deals with constituents over 3,000 since I've come to that office, day in and day out, preventing evictions, dealing with homelessness, ensuring that benefits and supports and resources are provided to individuals and families. So I am Harlem, and I certainly think that I stand on the shoulders of the legacy of all of those who've come before me. I've worked with Councilwoman Inez Dickens, and she has given me her personal support. I've worked with Congressman Rangel, I've worked with Assemblyman Keith Wright, I've worked with Senator Perkins, and none of them can say anything but the fact that
you were asked where you live.
I am Harlem. But I have had Harlem as my stomping ground. I have woken up and spent 18, 19-hour days in Harlem and have worked with national organizations in Harlem for many, many, many years.
Thank you, Mr.
Fields.
My question is, me being the only one up here that is 25 years of age, and everybody is living in 50s, I want to know what steps, and I wish I could open this up to everybody, but unfortunately, we're limited. But I want to know what steps have you taken, or will you take, if you win this election, to cultivate and nurture the young talent that is in this district? For the role of a public official is not only to help and represent the constituents in which they're charged under, but it's to sow seeds and extend olive branches for those people that may look differently or believe differently, to give them an opportunity to ascend to that very position. And unfortunately, in this district, and in our politics as a whole, we have seen elected officials and politicians die in office and young people skirted opportunities to live. So my question is, what do we do?
All right, now.
And to cultivate young leaders.
Thank you, my brother. Please give him a round of applause. This is a very eloquent young man. But to answer this question, I'm active in the community. In the past, I've helped run the Blue Nile Rights of Passage program for the youth. That program actually focuses on civic engagement, getting folks acclimated with respect to how government works, what's the next step. As chair of the Fred Sand Political Action Committee, that was one of my charter, to make sure we reach out to all the various groups within the district, because our community is very diverse. We have, and this is one of the great things about Harlem, is wherever you go, there's a certain level of diversity. And the question is, how can we take that diversity, how can we create a level of inclusiveness and bring everyone to the table? Because this community doesn't belong to me or you, it belongs to all of us. And once we are able to bring our skill sets together and we're able to bring our talents on board, this community would thrive and become even more successful than it is. So that's what I've been doing, and I'll continue to do it, and I look forward to experiencing it for you. Thank you. Thank you. My question is for good old Senator Bill Perkins. You know, Senator Perkins has been in some type of elected office for over two decades now. Rent in Harlem have increased over 90% in the last decade underneath his watch. My question is, can we trust that this time around you'll do anything different, or can we expect another 90% increase?
I appreciate the misrepresentation of my record.
That's what needs the question.
I know this is a political debate, and so
ask God next.
Things that are not quite accurate. You know, we have not only fought rent increases as they were being proposed legislatively, but we have that have been a part of my staff, and including Michael Adams, who I see out there, taught tenants how to withhold their rent when the rent was too damn high and unaffordable and not worthy because of the living conditions that some of my constituents had to live in. So the record is clear. We have been in the forefront of the tenant rights movement and the tenant advocacy for affordability, not by defining outside of our neighborhoods' ability to pay, but what's in the pockets of the people where that affordability has to be paid. So I don't have any qualms about our struggle to fight against the rent laws that have been gentrifying our neighborhood. But it's not a fight that is over. Now, for some people, you want to use me as the excuse for why it happened? That's kind of like, really, you don't understand how the process works. You understand? So we are here, we've always been there. Some of you may even know that we were at your building when it was time for a rent strike. So you can get the kind of services that you need. So we don't have any embarrassment or shame for our advocacy as leaders in the movement to empower the tenants and those who live in this neighborhood from that point of view. Thank you.
Thank Thank you. I don't have a question for anybody. I just want to, Marvin, I did want to just ask you about comments about the TIL program. I just wanted you to, do you mean just people who have a vocation and people who have a
college?
You spoke to the TIL question. You talked about people who had a vocation, people who were in college, who were coming back to find a place to live. Did you mean that other people shouldn't be entitled to get into those apartments, the TIL? Okay, I just wanted, if you could clarify that.
That was, the idea was, it was twofold. One, in my conversations and campaigning, I've talked to a lot of people who have went off to college and come back and can't afford to live in Harlem. So I wanted to create a program inside of the council for those people in particular. The other thing that, one of the problems that some of the residents are having in the TIL program is having people with certain sets of skills that they don't have in those buildings. So to bring those people who went and developed certain skills in life, young people would come back to work with the people in the community to hang on to this property and to buy this property. There's a young brother in the audience, Edwin Torres, who I went in his building. Edwin can live anywhere he wants, but he came back to the community. He's using his skills. He's want to organize that building, but he's going to live there to keep the people in the building. So we need the people who leave and go and get education and come back and be able to live in Harlem. What's happening is that a lot of people are going, they're going off to school and they're coming back to Harlem and they can't live here. So I was thinking about a program for those people who were long-term Harlem residents or their parents were Harlem residents and to keep them here in Harlem.
Ms. Alves.
So I don't have a particular question for anybody, but I just want to say I'm privileged to be on the ballot, privileged to live in Harlem and be an actual Harlem resident, and that I do understand housing issues and I do understand the plight of Harlem people. And to show that I really do understand that the rent is too damn high, Jimmy. In 2010, I did a social experiment with Jimmy McMillan. Stand up. The rent is too damn high, and 43,000 people voting for him. He's the governor of New York. Just to highlight the fact that the rent was too damn high. So I just want to show that I do appreciate it, and that I did that single-handedly all by myself. Thank you.